Last but not least, the opening lecture is given by Dimitra Svendoni Menzu, Professor of Philosophy and Science at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. Professor, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Mr. President of the Congress, dear participants, colleagues, and friends, I am deeply honored to be invited to deliver a speech on Aristotle at this prestigious international conference. I wish to congratulate the President of the Congress, Professor Yannis Konstantinidis, the presidents of the affiliated societies, and all the team that has worked for this international conference to have to be a reality in these difficult and challenging times of the pandemic. And certainly, I wish to warmly welcome all participants in Greece, in our city of Thessaloniki, and in particular in Macedonia, the homeland of Aristotle. The title I have chosen for my speech today will make some of you wonder, what on earth has Aristotle to do with science? What could he teach us in our era of the admirable successes of science in such areas as physics, quantum mechanics, physics of elementary particles, biology, genetics, medicine in general, and rhinology in particular, to mention only some of the disciplines. Knowing how reasonable this question is, I will first try to illuminate some aspects of Aristotle's contribution to the foundation of the basic fields of science, and then to show how far ahead of his time was Aristotle, and how exciting it can be to open a dialogue with him today. But let me first start with a brief introduction on the impact Aristotle had in the history of human thought over a period of 24 centuries. It is well known that Aristotle, the pupil of Plato and the teacher of Alexander, who was born in 3084 BC, has dealt with an amazing range of topics covering all major branches of philosophy and extending in an impressive way to all basic fields of science as we know them today. In the 62 years he lived, he wrote more than 150 treatises, only one-fifth of which have been saved. His ideas on democracy, justice, law, city-state are only some of the depths of Europe and the world to Aristotle. His contribution to such areas as logic, metaphysics, moral and political philosophy, poetics, and rhetoric had a universal recognition through the centuries and continues to exercise an influence on our intellectual lives on a global scale. But what happened to that part of Aristotle's work related to science? Unfortunately, this has remained degraded for many centuries. The dominant view since the Renaissance has been that Aristotle's physics was a failure. This opinion was mainly due to the fact that the staggered philosophy of nature was in total disagreement with the basic principles which were established by the founders of scientific revolution and survived in Newtonian physics for at least three centuries. In Newton's clockwork universe, there was no space for Aristotle's dynamic worldview of real qualities, qualitative transformations, natural processes, and the becoming of nature. It is exactly this aspect of Aristotle's work that I have chosen to present to you today, hoping to defeat the traditional view that it was a sterile system and a failure. In particular, I will be referring to Aristotle's philosophy of nature, which includes the study of all aspects of the natural world, living and non-living. To present this part of work, let me start by saying that Aristotle is the earthly philosopher. Although he was the pupil of Plato for 20 years in Athens, in the Academy, his work is completely different. Plato has placed the real world in the realm of ideas up there in heaven. Aristotle stepped down to earth and, contrary to his teacher, argued that reality is to be found in the sensible, perceptible world around us, the world of motion, change, growth, development, generation, and corruption. So he indulged with incredible passion and love in observing all aspects of the natural world. For him, all code or realms of nature are marvelous. He would say even a nose is marvelous and must be studied. Plato would never do this. What makes Aristotle's enormous contribution to science extremely valuable and timeless, no matter how many mistakes he has made, is the fact that he contributed substantially to the birth of science and that he set up the very foundations of science. He gave us the reasoning, the logic, and the method of science. He told us that the main purpose of science is to discover the causes of things. He organized the complex material of the totality of the physical world in his 10 categories so as to be able to organize the variety and complexity of the physical world. He taught us that scientific knowledge cannot be cut in pieces, that the real scientist must have an overall understanding of the totality of knowledge. He invented the idea of self-organization, considering the whole as something more than the sum of the parts. To accomplish all this, Aristotle emphasized that the first step in the study of nature is observation. As a result, he made an incredible wealth of observations in all areas of philosophy of nature during his stay in Assos, in Asia Minor, in Lesbos and in Macedonia in the period of 347 to 335 BC. In his zoological and biological treatises, his remarkable descriptions of terrestrial and marine animals, their parts and organs, the different ways in which they reproduce, their diet, the environment they live in, reveal that he was a great observer of nature and a research scientist. He analyzed the parts of animals in trying to understand what their function and their interaction with the environment is. Based on his careful observations and detailed descriptions, he set up the famous Scala Naturae, the natural ladder, which is a hierarchical classification of the forms in which living beings appear. The only weak point is that this is not accompanied by an evolutionary theory. This has traditionally been recorded as his great failure as compared to Darwin. However, his critics seem to ignore a significant point. In his treatise, History of Animals, Historia Animalium, Aristotle was very careful to make clear that there are no sharp dividing lines between the different species as we go up the stairs of the Scala Naturae. He then explains in detail that the transition from one species to the other takes place without gaps, without jumps. This is exactly the idea expressed by Darwin's theory of evolution. For this reason, I always like to point out that Aristotle has laid down the basic preconditions for the theory of evolution. He was the one who built up the natural ladder, and after many centuries, Darwin came to push the button and make the ladder move. We must keep in mind that Aristotle's biology is closely related to his physics, as both are major parts of his philosophy of nature. In order to shed light on this connection, I will now pass to physics. In his treatise entitled Physics or Periphysios, Aristotle identifies natural things, ta physi onda, with those who are in movement, ta kinoumena. He then completes this picture by pointing out that when he refers to physi onda, natural things, he means the things that are connected with matter. I quote, all kinds of animals and their parts, all plants, as well as the simple bodies, earth, air, fire, water, end of quote. All these, the staggered claims, have within themselves the principle of movement and rest. This is an extremely important idea. In Aristotle's dynamic model of the world, there is no place for Newton's inert matter. All material things have an inner principle of movement. Let us see how Aristotle explains this. According to his theory, all things in nature are a compound of matter and form, ύλη και μορφή, είδος. Μορφή, είδος are two words for the same thing, but with different meanings. Equally important is the corresponding ontological pair of potential and actual being, and dynamic και en energia on. These are the main pillars of Aristotle's ontology and philosophy of nature. To give some of Aristotle's examples, plain examples, the statue is already potentially in the marble. The seed of the peach that we planted in our garden is potentially the future plant. The embryo, the fetus in the mother's womb, is potentially the future newborn baby. In nature, there is always a passage from potentiality to actuality, which is a qualitative change, an inner motion, a physical process. Aristotle is very interested in the physical processes. Nature for Aristotle, in its totality, is not a static system, but a complex and dynamic one, which is in constant movement and change. Thus, matter and form, eidos, play a central role in Aristotle's dynamic model of nature. But what exactly is eidos? Species form is the translation in English. Contrary to what most of Aristotle's students believe, eidos, species form, is not a metaphysical concept outside the sphere of physical reality. It is the innate nature of a thing, which is the basis, the foundation, for natural kinds as we know them in biology. It is interesting to see how Aristotle explains his treatise on generation of animals, the procedure by which reproduction takes place and the fetus is created. He refers to the contribution of the two factors. What the male contributes to generation is the species form, eidos, and the principle of movement, while the female contributes the body and the matter. Of course, we know today that this is wrong. However, in what follows, Aristotle expresses a most brilliant idea. What he tells us, in contemporary terms, is that the species form, eidos, is the information or mathematical formula or the genetic program that was transmitted to the fetus by its parents. In other words, it is the DNA of biological organisms which encloses in it all the information necessary for the development of the living being in all subsequent stages of its development. I am sure many of you will now be thinking, this is certainly an idea of a philosopher who has a great admiration for Aristotle, like me. I am afraid I will disappoint you. This is an idea initially put forward by the physicist and biologist Max Delbruck, the Nobel Prize winner in medicine in 1969, for his research on bacteriophage viruses. In an article dedicated to Aristotle and entitled Aristotle, Total, Total, he wanted to show that there is a continuous of the effect and the influence of Aristotle till our days. Aristotle, Total, Total. Max Delbruck argued, I quote, that if that committee in Stockholm, which has an enviable task each year of pointing out the most creative scientists, had the liberty of giving awards posthumously, I think they should consider Aristotle for the discovery of the principle implied in DNA. This is an interesting proposition that I think they should take into account. I now come to one of the most exciting, in my opinion, ideas of Aristotle's contribution to philosophy of nature, the idea of prime matter, πρώτη ύλη. To understand the value of it, we should remember that the dominant view since the Renaissance has been that Aristotle's physics was a failure because it could not fit in the characteristics of science that were introduced by Copernicus, Kepler, and Galileo in the 16th and 17th centuries, and subsequently by Newton. However, today, the impressive discoveries in such areas as quantum mechanics and physics of elementary particles have shown the limitations of the Newtonian scientific model and the need for fundamental changes in the way we see the physical world. This, I believe, can be found in the work of Aristotle. Let us now come to his theory of πρώτη ύλη, prime matter. Aristotle was the first in the history of mankind to ask the question, what is the matter of things in nature are made of? This, as we all know, is also the question that is the object of research for the last 65 years by the scientists of CERN in Geneva. To answer the question, Aristotle argued that beneath the sensible world of our experience of actual, concrete, sensible, individual objects, there is a deeper fundamental level of matter, which he called πρώτη ύλη, materia prima, prime matter. I quote, prime matter is the ultimate substratum of all change, το έσχατον υποκείμενον της μεταβολής. It lacks every determination and has a potential being. I quote, the ultimate matter and the form are one and the same. The one is potentially and the other actually. All the above are quite confusing. For many centuries, Aristotle scholars have been asking, what is prime matter after all for Aristotle? Does it have a physical reality in the material world around us, or is it only a conception of the mind with no real physical content? The dominant view has been that prime matter is an empty concept with no physical content. Contrary to this view, my answer is, according to my reading of Aristotle, the following. Prime matter has a physical, Aristotle's prime matter has a physical reality. It is part of the physical world and plays a central role in the Stagirist dynamic model. Prime matter and form, potentiality and actuality, are indistinguishable elements of nature. We must also remember that the physical process for Aristotle is a qualitative movement as a passage from potentiality to actuality is taking place. When a green apple turns into red as it is ripening, when the cold water starts boiling, when the embryo becomes a baby, when my nose starts bleeding, all these are instances of an internal movement of a physical process. Underneath all this stands prime matter as a substratum, υποκείμενο of all change, as a moving power in nature. I therefore believe that is this strange, but at the same time ingenious conception of prime matter by Aristotle that can allow us to shed light to some surprising analogies that one can find in the corresponding picture of matter as it emerges from within the world of contemporary physics. Indeed, when one crosses the threshold of quantum world, strange things happen and a completely different physical reality is revealed. Subatomic particles, such as electrons, neutrons, positrons, muons, pions, and their antiparticles, are not and do not behave like billiard balls, as it is the case with Newton's atomic theory. In other words, they do not have properties that are traditionally attributed to matter in the context of classical physics. What is surprising when we penetrate into the composition of the atom is that the particles, the so-called particles, are no longer the rigid, stable, well-defined building blocks of matter, as was the case with the atoms of Democritus in ancient times and Newton in modern times. Their presence in space has no clear boundaries, but neither does it have the stability that characterizes the objects of classical physics. Instead, as all kinds of transformations of particles into each other take place, there is a continuous interplay between potentiality and actuality, quote, which takes the form of an inner motion, end of quote, as David Bohm, one of the most significant theoretical physicists of the 20th century, has pointed out in his book, Causality and Chance in Modern Physics. All these astonishing facts of experimental research, which was developed especially in the middle of the 20th century and continues with great success to the present day, support the view that the way Aristotle sees nature is much closer than Newtonian physics to the image of nature in contemporary science. I wish to conclude by saying that Aristotle's sights in all areas of his work make him a completely contemporary thinker with whom we can open a dialogue. Thus, my suggestion, which also introduces a neo-Aristotelianism in the philosophy of science, is that we must attempt a rereading of Aristotle's work in the light of recent discoveries in all fields of science. The current results of experimental research, and I will finish with this, can give new life to Aristotle's dynamic vision of nature, and at the same time may suggest new ways of understanding contemporary science. Thank you very much on behalf of Aristotle.